Spirit, one God. Amen.
Welcome to Kids Corner. I'm so glad that you joined us today. We're going to have another exciting story from my favorite book, and I'm sure it's your favorite book too. It's God's Word. God spoke through men, and they wrote down what He told them to write. So it's God's exact words. We have someone who wants to say a few words first. Well, hi, Eddie. How are you today?
Well, I'm terrible. Oh, sorry. But, you know, I just don't have any friends. No one seems to like Eddie. Ah, I'm all by myself. Oh, it's terrible.
Well, Eddie, it can't be that bad. What in the world happened? I'm sure you have some friends.
Well, no, I don't think I have any. You see, there was a birthday party, and I didn't get invited. Everybody else went, but not me. I feel so left out. Oh, I just feel like there isn't anybody in the world who likes Eddie. Oh, sorry, but it just makes me feel sad. I just am on the verge of crying a lot. Well, I didn't want to admit to you that I cry, but, well, when I'm alone, yes, I do. I just can't hold back those tears. Oh, excuse me. Yeah, all right.
Well, Eddie, do you know that there is someone who does love you very much?
What? There's someone who loves me? I don't know who. Right now, I feel like everybody else has friends, but not Eddie.
Well, Eddie, in our story today, there was a man, and he truly didn't have any friends. He truly was alone.
Wow. I bet that was horrible. I don't know what I'd do. I just think that's the worst thing, to have no friends at all. Terrible.
Well, Eddie, you just stay today, and you're going to find out that someone did love him, and someone that loves everyone.
Oh, I bet I know who that is. But I'm going to stay. I want to see, does somebody really love me all the time? Oh, that would be so wonderful. I would love to be loved.
Well, all right, Eddie. Well, you can go now, and you can just stay, and you'll find out who loves you for sure.
Oh, okay. I'm going. Oh, bye, everybody. Mwah, mwah, mwah. I love you. I know you're my friend. I know each one of you out there loves me, and I love you too. Oh, bye, bye.
Have any of you ever been lost?
Yes.
You didn't know where your parents were and you were wondering? What if, when you were lost, your parents said, "Why don't we go to Disneyland? You know, it would be so much cheaper. We'd have one less person to pay for." And so, they went to Disneyland. And they were there. And they thought, you know what, after we go to Disneyland, we might want to do a few other things. Then we'll worry about the person that is lost. What would you think? There you were. You had no shelter. You had no food. You didn't know where your parents were. Wouldn't you feel awful? Well, you know, the Bible says that we are lost, each one of us. So what are we lost from? Well, the Bible says that we are lost from God. And of course, we are lost in our sin. Yes, we are lost in our sin. And you know, it means that we're separated from God. We're not, you know, God is everywhere. But we're lost, we're separated. Our punishment is going to be living without Him forever. But God said, I love you. He came down to this earth, and He came down to give His life on the cross for our sin. Because the punishment for our sin is to be separated from God. But in order to have our sins forgiven, the Bible says that without shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness. So Jesus says, I love you. I will shed my blood. And so He did. And of course, then we can be found. We can be part of God's family and live with Him forever. Now, our memory verse today says, the Son of Man has come. Now, the Son of Man. Who do you think the Son of Man is? Well, this verse, Jesus was speaking, and He calls Himself the Son of Man. And so Jesus was, He's talking about Himself. He says, for I came to seek. Now, if I'm seeking something, I'm looking for it. Where is it? Where did I leave that? I'm looking. And He says, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. You know what, kids? He came and He says, well, I'm there you are. He there you are. And after He found us, what did He do? He came to seek that which was lost, which was you and I. But after He found us, the Bible says He came to seek and to save us. He didn't just say, oh, I see you. You're lost. Oh, too bad. He says, no, I will save you. I will save you. I will save you from why you are lost so you can be found and you can live forever with me in heaven. God has a glorious plan for us, and He has that plan for you, and He wants to save you. And the Bible says that we can be saved. It says, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. And by believing in Jesus, we need to put our faith and trust in Him and believe the truth. And the truth is, He is the only one that can save us from our sins. I hope you have put your faith and trust in Him. Well, right now, we are going to sing this verse. But let me show you the motions first. I'll put the verse right here. All right. Now, the motions are the Son of Man. And who did we say the Son of Man was? It was
Jesus.
Thank you. So it's the Son of Man. We're putting to the nail prints in His hand. For the Son of Man has come to seek, to look for, to seek, and then to save. We're in bondage. Oh, I'm in bondage, but now I'm free to save. And that which was, because He came to save people. So we're pointing to other people. That which was lost. Now, lost, this is mine. I have it. Oh, but I lost it. So that which was lost. All right, I think we can all do that. All right, let's all try it together.
For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. To save that which was lost. To save
Very good. You know what? We're going to try it one more time.
For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. To save that which was lost. To save that which was lost. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save.
One more time. Oh, I love this verse, don't you?
For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. To save that which was lost. To save that which was lost. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save.
Now, in our story today, there was a man that was just like Eddie. The only difference was this man truly had no friends. People did not like him at all. He was a tax collector, and he collected taxes for the enemies of the Israelite people. He collected it for the Romans, but he was an Israelite. And what he would do, he would say, you owe me $50. Do you know what I think? I think I'll collect $75. And so he would go up to the person and say, give me $75. And then he would take $25 and he would pocket it. It was like stealing. And this man was the chief tax collector. Now, he had a beautiful home. Oh, yes, he had a lot of money. He could buy anything that he wanted. But do you think that his money made him happy? I don't think so. You know, the reason that a person wants money is so they can enjoy it with their friends and their family. But there wasn't anyone that would come to his house. They would not step foot in there except maybe another hated tax collector. Well, the Bible tells us that his name was Zacchaeus, and he was very rich. But Zacchaeus was very short. And we're going to see in our story today what he does. It says that Jesus was coming to his town, and Zacchaeus wanted to see Jesus. Everybody in Israel had heard about the miracles that Jesus did. He would make a blind person see. He could take a person who was lying on a bed, completely paralyzed, get up and start walking. And everybody who came to him, he was able to heal people that had the dreaded disease of leprosy. And so Zacchaeus, when he heard that Jesus was coming to town, he wanted to see him. But he knew that wherever Jesus went, there was a large crowd. Well, Zacchaeus knew that he would never be able to see Jesus over the crowd. He was way too short. And so, as the crowd came, Zacchaeus thought, my only hope is if I can run ahead and maybe find something tall, and then I could see him. And Zacchaeus, he was running ahead of the crowd, and he was running ahead of the crowd. He saw a sycamore tree. Now, this sycamore tree must have had low-lying limbs. And so Zacchaeus thought, I could climb up in that sycamore tree. It was probably right along the road. So he knew that Jesus, with that crowd, would be passing by. But Zacchaeus would be up in the tree, so he would be able to see Jesus. Now, you know, kids, Zacchaeus was very wealthy. And in those days, if you had a lot of money, You would wear these fancy robes, and when you moved, you would move with dignity, and you would just kind of slowly walk along. But Zacchaeus, he says, I don't care. I have got to see Jesus. And so in his fancy robes, he ran. And in his fancy robes, he just climbed right up into that sycamore tree. And so Zacchaeus, he climbed up in the tree and he got in a good spot. And he thought, now I'll be able to see Jesus when he comes. Well, it wasn't very long before here came the crowds. And so Jesus came with all the crowds. And this is our sign for Jesus. So let's see. And Jesus came with all the crowds. Very good. And when Jesus stood right under that tree, he looked up and he said, the Bible says, he looked up right into the eyes of Zacchaeus and he said, Zacchaeus? Now Jesus knew Zacchaeus' name. And Zacchaeus, he was surprised. Can you do that? He was surprised.
Zacchaeus was surprised.
Because Jesus knew his name. Jesus knows every one of your names. Jesus made you. He created you. He loves you. He came down to this earth to find you. He wants you to live in heaven with him someday. And he came for Zacchaeus too. And he said, Zacchaeus, hurry up, come down. And so Zacchaeus came down. When Jesus tells you to do something, I hope you do it. And Zacchaeus, he immediately just came down from that tree. And Zacchaeus, he looked at Jesus. Now, Zacchaeus was a man that nobody liked. And all of the chief priests and the Pharisees and the religious leaders of that day, they wouldn't say one thing to Zacchaeus. They didn't like him. They didn't want him around. They wouldn't give him the time of day. And here was Jesus. Jesus was the greatest man. He had come from God. And he wanted to talk to Zacchaeus. He says, Zacchaeus, hurry up, come down. And then he said something shocking. Everybody was so surprised. He said, I must stay at your house. Zacchaeus couldn't believe it. Jesus was going to stay at his house that day. And then the Bible tells us how Zacchaeus felt. Zacchaeus felt in a way that he had not felt for years. Do you think he was just prideful? Oh, Jesus is going to stay at my house. The Bible says no. The Bible says that he was full of joy. He was absolutely full of joy that Jesus was going to be at his house. And so the Bible says, though, that Zacchaeus, he believed in the Lord Jesus because he changed. He became a different person. Zacchaeus became a different person. In fact, you know what Zacchaeus said? He said, half of my money I am going to give to the poor. And then he said that if I have stolen anything, I'm going to give back four times. Now, kids, for him to say, I'm going to give back four times, he was admitting that he was a thief, because that was what a thief did. If you stole anything in those days, they didn't put you in jail. They just said, all right, you need to give back four times what you have taken. Now, it also tells us one thing, too. A lot of what Zacchaeus had, he hadn't stolen. He was able to give one half back to the poor and then give to those he'd stolen, and he would still have some left over. Do you know, kids, this what also tells us? that if you have taken something that was wrong, if you've stolen anything, you need to make it right. You know, he says, I'll give half to the poor. Well, that's fine, but if you've stolen it from someone and you know who you've stolen it from, you can't just give it, oh, I'll just give this so much over here. You go find the person that you have stolen from and you make it right. Your life needs to change. And Zacchaeus' life, when he met the Lord Jesus, it changed. He was in Jericho. Zacchaeus lived in Jericho. He was the chief tax collector. I can tell you that the whole city of Jericho was different because of this one man. Can you imagine in a city where he would take half of everything? Oh, you need help? Can I help you? Can I help you? And then, oh, let me give this back. And probably even some of the tax collectors under him, they changed too. One man can make a difference. Do you know what everybody thought of this one man? They hated him. They thought, why? In fact, the crowd, they were so surprised. Jesus, why are you going to his house? In fact, the Bible says that those around him, they complained, saying, it says all complained. Maybe even his disciples complained. And they said, he has gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner. But you know what Jesus knew? Jesus knew that in his heart he had changed. And Jesus, he came to save the sinner. He says, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save those that are good, those that do everything right. No, he says, I came to save the lost. Zacchaeus was lost. I came to save him. Oh, that is so wonderful to know that the Lord Jesus Christ, he has come to seek you and to save you. Now, I know a young boy, and this young boy, I can tell which family he belongs to because he looks just a little bit like his father. And then when I look at him, I can see his mother in him too. Now, there are two families, and you are a member of either one or the other of these two families. Now, the first family, and this is the family that you're born into, and I hate to tell you what the Bible says, but the Bible says that if you are in this family, then your father is the devil. Oh, that is... we don't want that, do we? But you can tell someone who belongs to this family. Because somebody in this family, you can tell, oh yes, ah, they're always fighting. Uh-huh, I can tell which family they belong to. Oh, maybe they just tell lies. You ask them things and they won't tell you the truth. You know, another way to tell if they're in that family is, you know, they're just, oh, I don't like this person and I don't like that person. But you know what? There's another family. And that family, oh, I hope that you're a member of that family. But that family is... it's God's family. And he says, I want you to be my children. I made you to be part of my family and to live forever in heaven with me. Now, if we're born into this family, well, how do we all of a sudden get to be in this family? Do you reach a certain age? You do a lot of good things. You know, you pay a lot of money. How can you become part of this other family? Well, we already know the answer to that. And the answer to that is that the blood of Jesus Christ, when it cleanses us from all our sins, remember, it's more than just forgiveness. Those sins are washed away as if they never existed. Then we can become part of God's family. Now, when you become part of God's family, your life should be like Zacchaeus. You should be different. And people should look at you. Kids, you don't want to be like everybody else. You have a new father and a new family. And when people look at you, they should see that is someone who obeys When someone asks you to do something, you say, yes, ma'am, yes, sir, I would be delighted. And you do it immediately. And someone in that family, they also love. They're kind. They're kind to others. They don't bully. They don't make fun. And you know what? They also had what Zacchaeus had. What did Zacchaeus have? He was full of joy. That's right. And so now, if someone were to look at you, would they be able to tell which family you belong to? Would they say, they're always fighting. You know what? They're always trying to get back at other people. You know, they can't just let something pass. You know, they really don't obey. You know, that they're just full of, I don't like this person and I don't like that person, and they're not kind. Or would they look at you and say, you know, he obeys his parents, those over him. He shows love to other people, and he's happy even when things don't go his way. You know, it's everybody's happy when things go your way. But when things don't go your way, you say, it's okay. That's all right. So which family would you be? I hope that you're part of God's family. And if you're not part of God's family, you can be part of his family today. Now, when you become part of God's family, do you know in your families, do you have rules that you have to be in bed by a certain time? That you can only watch so much TV and you can only watch certain programs? Maybe you guys all have to eat together at the dinner table. Well, when you are in God's family, there are certain rules too. First of all, you need to read the Bible. Do you listen to your parents? Well, you know, when you read the Bible, that's like listening to what God has to say. He says, okay, you're a part of my family. Now we have some things I would like you to learn. And then you need to trust the Lord. Do you trust your dads to make the living, to come home, to provide things for you? You don't worry about what am I going to eat or where am I going to sleep. You know your dad's going to take care of that. And so you know what? You need to trust the Lord because he says, I'm your father. I will take care of you now. And then, do you have to obey your parents? I hope so. If you have good parents, they will make you obey. They will teach you the importance to obey. I know some kids, and they've never learned to obey. What they don't know is they're going to have a very sad life because of it. Well, God wants you to obey him. And then do you talk to your mom and dad? Well, God says, I want you to talk to me too. And that's called prayer. And then if you've done something wrong, I hope you go to your parents and say, you know, Mom, I shouldn't have done that. You know, Dad, that wasn't right. And God wants you to do the same thing. He wants you to confess your sins. I shouldn't have done this. And kids, you don't confess your sin and then say, okay, I've confessed my sin. Now I can just go do it again. That's not confessing your sin. Confessing your sin isn't just saying what you've done. It is agreeing that it was wrong. I did this wrong. I was jealous. I lied. That was wrong. You have to agree with God that it was wrong. And then, of course, he wants you to love each other. And you know, you're supposed to love your brothers and sisters, and it's hard. But God says you need to learn to do that. And then he wants you to tell others. Tell others about how they can be part of his family. They don't have to have their father be anyone but God. And then, of course, he wants you to go to church. He wants you to be with other people that love him. He wants you to be with your family. And so these are rules that God has in his family. so glad that you joined us today. I am so thankful that you're here. And just remember, if you're part of God's family, your life should be different. Okay, we'll see you next time. Bye. Bye. Bye, everyone. We love you. Bye.